ॐ सहनावतु सहनोभुनक्तु सहवीर्यङ्करवावहै तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहै ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः। नमः श्री शंकरानंद, नमः श्री शंकरानंद गुरुपादाम्बुजन्मने, गुरुपादाम्बुजन्मने सविलास महामोह, सविलास महामोह ग्राहग्रासैककर्मणे, ग्राहग्रासैककर्मणे। The question that is being discussed is that when a wise person acts, then he is performing functions through the body, he is transacting various activities with the world, he is functioning in the realm of duality in general. Does that negate or displace his knowledge of non-duality? Does it in any way threaten his knowledge of non-duality? So this is the idea that you perceive the duality, all right. Is the perception of duality, does it negate his knowledge of non-duality? The answer is no. Perception of duality is not opposed to the knowledge of non-duality, because the non-dual is not opposed to duality. The non-dual is in spite of duality. What has happened to the wise man is the duality no more has any reality. That's the only difference, that an ignorant person gives reality to the duality. That I am different and the world is different. So this duality that is perceived, duality between the subject and the object, which is what we call the perceptual or experiential duality, is given reality by an ignorant person, whereas a wise man does not give it reality, having known that both the subject and object, both of them are rooted in the same reality, which is the basis for both the subject as well as object. Like two waves striking against each other, both the waves have their reality in water. And similarly also, the subject has his reality in the same consciousness in which the object also has a reality. And therefore, one who knows the essence of both of them to be one, he is not in any way threatened by, or not in any way deviated from his knowledge of non-duality just because of his transactions in the realm of duality. And this is being said in so many verses. Na vidya na vitatkaryam bodham bhasitum arhati puraiva tattva bodhena bhaditete ubhayatah. Said in verse 278, it is neither ignorance nor the products of ignorance that they can in any way negate the bodha, negate the knowledge, because by the knowledge the ignorance has been removed and by the knowledge the duality has been shown to be apparent. Bhaditam drashyatam akshayi tena badho na shakyate jivan nakhur namajaram hanti hanyat kasam vratah. Akshayi bhaditam drashyatam, may the sense organs perceive this duality, which has been bhaditam, which has been falsified. Tena badhona shakyade, the duality which has been falsified cannot in any way negate the knowledge, which is real. So just as my shadow cannot in any way affect my body, the shadow is unreal, keeps changing, or my reflection doesn't have any effect upon the body which is reflected, and so also the duality which is a projection upon non-duality does not in any way affect the non-dual. Like the snake which is projected upon the rope, or like the mirage water which you perceive. The perception of mirage water, once you know that it is mirage water, then the perception of mirage water does not in any way disturb you, or does not in any way deviate you from the knowledge that the mirage water is false. So jivan akurnamajaram hanti hanyat kasam vratah, this duality, even when it was alive, could not in any way affect the non-duality, Whereas the question of the duality is now proven to be false, that it cannot in any way affect the non-duality. Interestingly said in the verse 281, Adahu avidya chitrahi svakaryai jirmhamanaya yudhva bodho jayatsodhya sudrado badhitam katham. Adahu, in the beginning, vidyaram vidya abhyasa samaye, in the process of pursuing the knowledge, avidya chitrahi svakaryai jirmhamanaya avidya yudhva. This bodha, meaning this knowledge, this soldier or the warrior in the form of knowledge had to constantly give a fight to ignorance and the products of ignorance. What is pursuit of knowledge is nothing but fighting against the ignorance and the products of ignorance, to know them to be false. So pramatratva, bhauktratva, kartratva, jnumahanaya, this ignorance really was so powerful and so spread out by its products in the form of the doer, the enjoyer, the knower, all these different facets of the ego were the products of ignorance, and this warrior of the knowledge had to fight a battle against all these, the enemies, the enemy soldiers, like the different facets of the ego which were the product of ignorance. So this fight had taken place, and yudha bodha ajayat, and the knowledge conquered them all. So knowledge conquered the ignorance and conquered all the products of ignorance also. Sudraha, and subsequently Abhyasapatavena Sudraha Adya, and subsequently Abhyasapatavena, by the propensity of the Abhyasa or the repeated assimilation. Now that the knowledge has been completely assimilated and has been made spontaneous, where the question that this ignorance or the products of ignorance can in any way affect or injure this knowledge, cannot injure. In short, that knowledge is gained only when the ignorance is destroyed. Not only when the ignorance is destroyed, but even the products of ignorance. What are the products of ignorance? Avidya, asmita, raga, dvesha, abhinivesha. This is the process. Avidya, the ignorance. Asmita, the ego, the sense of individuality. Raga, the attachment. Dvesha, the aversion. Abhinivesha, the fear. So these were all the products of ignorance, and all of them have been dealt with by the knowledge, and therefore they are all dead. And these dead products of ignorance, like the dead bodies, cannot in any way, like the dead mouse cannot in any way threaten the cat, and so also these dead things cannot in any way threaten this warrior of knowledge. This is his way of saying that it's like throwing mud against a rock. How the mud has no effect upon the rock, and so also the perception of duality, the functioning in the realm of duality, does not have any effect upon the knowledge, which is solid. Continuing in the verse 282, Upapadiram artham srotra buddhya arohaya rupakena aha. Srotra buddhi arohaya. In order again to make this meaning, this point that has been discussed and logically shown, in order to make it firm in the mind of the student, a rupaka, meaning an allegory, is presented here in that form again. The very same point is made by the author in the verses 282 and 283. Says the verse 282, Tishthantva jnana tatkarya shava bodhena maritaha nabhitir bodha samrajaha kirtif pratyutatasyadaihi. He is describing in the language of the battlefield how the battle had taken place between the warrior in the form of knowledge and the enemies in the form of ignorance and the products of ignorance, and how this king of the knowledge has already won that battle. tishtantu ajnana tat karyashavaha bodhena marikaha. Ignorance and the products of ignorance, namely ego, likes and dislikes and all this, bodhena marikaha, all of them have been already killed or destroyed by bodha, by the knowledge. Tishtantu ajnana tat karyashavaha. This dead body of course is of ignorance and the products of ignorance. Tishtantu, let them be there. All of them have already been destroyed by the warrior of knowledge in the battlefield. Na bhiti hi bodh samrad hai. Just as a samrad, meaning a king or an emperor, who has conquered the enemy, and the enemy soldiers are all lying dead in the battlefield, how these dead soldiers do not cause any fear to the conquering king or a conquering emperor? Kirti hi pratyuta tasyaraihi. On the other hand, more the soldiers are killed, more in fact is the kirti, meaning more is the fame. So this fellow, it is his glory that he has conquered so many enemies, and therefore when the enemy is conquered, when the enemy soldiers are lying dead on the battlefield, how those dead soldiers are no cause for fear for the conquering king. On the other hand, it only glorifies, it only speaks of his glory that he has conquered these. And similarly also, the king of what we call the knowledge, bodha, or the knowledge or the wisdom, has already destroyed ignorance and the products of ignorance. They are all lying dead before him. Dead means as good as dead. The world of the duality is as good as dead in as much as it is false. Even though the wise man functions in the realm of duality, all right, but in his eyes, the duality has no reality at all, and therefore, its reality is gone, so it is as good as dead. It is totally ineffective, and therefore, the perception of duality and the transaction in the realm of duality in no way affect the knowledge. This is the idea. Bhavatu evam prakrute kimayatam. All right, let it be that a king is, the conquering king is, has no fear from the dead soldiers. In fact, more than number of dead soldiers is a glorification of the conquering king. Let it be so. What relevance does it have in the subject matter and the discussion? And says in the verse 283, Ya eva mati shurena, Ya eva mati shurena, Bodhe nanaviyujyade, Bodhe nanaviyujyade, Pravrityava nivrityava, Pravrityava nivrityava, Deha digatayasyakim, Deha digatayasyakim. Ya evam atishurena bodhena navyujyade. Yahapuman, a person, a wise man, evam, in this manner, atishurena bodhena navyujyade. This knowledge, or it is called bodha in Sanskrit, bodha means knowledge. Atishurena, which is very valorous or powerful, this bodha or the knowledge, the king or the warrior in the form of knowledge, which is so powerful, which is valorous, avidya tatkari ghatakena, which has destroyed the enemy in the form of ignorance and all the products of ignorance, and therefore this bodha, the knowledge which has conquered, brahmatmaikatva jnanena. What is the nature of knowledge? Brahmatmaikatva jnanam. The knowledge which reveals the duality of Brahman and Atma, or the knowledge that reveals the self to be Brahman, that is the knowledge. And that has destroyed the ego. What is it that destroys ego? Only the knowledge. And what does the knowledge do? Knowledge only reveals the falsity of the ego. It is like the snake being destroyed by the knowledge of a rogue. And similarly also, the ego is destroyed by the knowledge of the true nature of the self. And when the self is revealed to be limitless or Brahman, then all the sense of limitation is falsified, is destroyed, is no more there. It may be there, you know, as like an actor assumes a role and plays the role of a beggar, and so also a wise man, for the purpose of transaction, identifies the body and functions like other people, but then that sense of individuality is no more there. So avidya tatkari ghatakena bodhena. This knowledge which reveals the oneness of Brahman in the self, or which reveals the self to be Brahman, to be limitless, by this knowledge which has been destroyed, ignorance and the ego, the product of ignorance. So person or a wise man, na viyujyate, na kadabhi viyukto bhavati. When this knowledge has been assimilated by what we call abhyasa, or constant practice, there is an obstacle in the form of what we call habitual error, the habit of identifying with the body. And by nididhyasanam, constant practice, one who has overcome this force of habit, and one who has gained an abidance in the knowledge, he is not going to be in any way any more separated from this knowledge, because it is knowledge of the self. I can never be separated from myself. And I always have the knowledge of myself also. At the moment, my knowledge of myself is, let us say, false. But when I know myself truly for what it is, there is no way that I can forget it, or no way that I can be separated from it. And when I am not separated by this knowledge, which is comparable to a conquering king, what can the dead ignorance and the products of ignorance do? They cannot have any effect at all. And therefore, for such a wise man, pravrtyava nivrtyava kim? What does he lose by pravrtti or performing activities? Or nivrtti by disengagement from activities, what does he lose? He has nothing to gain by activity, nor does he have to lose by non-activity. An ordinary person, an ignorant person, has something to accomplish by performance of an activity. And if he fails to perform an action that he should have performed, he stands to gain, he stands to lose. Wise man has nothing to gain, nor anything to lose. And therefore, pravrtyava nivrtyava kim? Asya pumsaha dehadigataya dehadinishtaya pravrtya nivrtyava kim? Kim api istam anistam va ityardaha. So, where are the pravrtti or activities? Where? In the body, in the speech, in the mind. The activity is never the self. And what we call nivritti or disengagement or inactivity also is where? That also is in the body, speech and the mind. Atma, the self, is free from both the ideas of pravritti and nivritti, or engagement and disengagement. Therefore, let the body perform its actions. He said earlier. So, let the body perform the worships. I have nothing to lose by that. Devarsana snana shauja bhikshadu vasatam vapuhu. It was said earlier. Let the body engage itself in the worship of gods, or in bathing, in cleaning, in asking for bhiksha. Let the body perform all the activities. I am the witness. I have nothing to gain or lose. Taram japadu vaktadvat. Let my speech repeat the various mantras, Om Pranam Mantra. Padhatu amnaya mastakam. Let the speech recite the Vedas, or let the speech study the scriptures. Vishnum dhyayadu dhiryadva, or may my mind meditate upon God. Brahmanande viliyatam, or may my mind get absorbed in the ananda of Brahman. So let these activities take place at the level of the body, speech and the mind. Sakshiham kinchidapyatra na kurve napikare. I'm a witness of all the activities of the body, speech and the mind. Na kurve, I don't do anything. Napikare, nor do I make them do. It is not that I am forcing, or I am compelling, or even prompting this body, speech and the mind into activities. They just perform activities on their own. How can they perform activities on their own? They perform activities as motivated by what we call prarabdha or destiny. In my presence, all of them become alive, and by the force of destiny, they perform their activities. I do not interfere in the activities of the body, speech and the mind. Neither do I prompt them into activity, nor do I prompt them into disengagement of activities. So, wise man says that, what does it matter if the body is active? Why should I even come in the way of activity of the body? You know Ramana Maharshi, and Ramana Maharshi was suffering from cancer, it was discovered. And some devotee asked Ramana Maharshi, a great sage, why don't you use your spiritual powers and eliminate this cancer? So why should I do that? I don't want to come in the way of the natural working of the body. I don't want to interfere. A wise man does not interfere. In nature, does not interfere with anything. Therefore, the self is called Upadrashta Anumanta. In Bhagavad Gita, the self, Atma, is described by Lord Krishna as Upadrashta. The one who is watches, who is close and closely watching everything. Anumanta, one who permits everything to happen, does not interfere with anything. And so, why should a wise man interfere with the activities of the body? Therefore, it was said earlier that even if the activities are Shastriya, meaning in accordance with the scriptural injunctions, or anyatha, even if the activities against the scriptural injunction, since wise man does not have the sense of doership, since the wise man does not perform any activity to begin with, he is unconcerned whether the activities taking place at the level of body, speech and mind are in keeping with scriptural injunctions or they are not. He does not interfere with them. They simply follow their laws. So body follows the laws of matter. Body, speech and the mind follows the laws of karma or laws of action. And therefore it is law of action or the destiny that determines what they do. Kim na kimapi ishtam anishtam va. There is nothing that is desirable or undesirable for him. Says Bhagavad Gita, yastvātma ridarevasyāt ātma truptasya mānavah ātmanyavacha santuṣṭah tasya kāryam na vidyate. Yastu ātma ratihi vasyāt, one who revels in the self, ātma truptasya mānavah, one who is totally content with oneself, ātmanyavacha santuṣṭah, one is totally satisfied with the self, tasya kāryam na vidyate, there nothing remains to be done for that person. One who revels in the self, one who is happy with the self, one who is totally satisfied with the self, one is content with the self, therefore that person, nothing remains to be done. Naiva tasya krutena arthaha na kruteneha kaschana. There is nothing that wise person has to accomplish by performance of an action, nor that person have to lose something by non-performance of an action. Na chasya sarva bhuteshu kaschid artha vyapashraya. He is not dependent upon anything for his welfare because welfare is his own nature and therefore he does not depend upon anything in this world to bring about his welfare. Therefore, why should he perform activity? Why should he not perform an activity? He does not perform activity to begin with and therefore to insist that the wise man should do a given thing or not do a given thing, it does not make sense because he is not available for any injunctions. Only the person who has a sense of doership, one who is conscious, self-conscious, I am doing a given thing. Thus, one who superimposes a sense of doership on the self, that person is available for injunction. Do this and don't do that. One who identifies the body or the mind or the speech, that's the person who will follow, he is available for instruction and that person will follow the instruction. Say, may a brahmana do this, you know, or may a learned person do this? But who will do that? Only the person who considers himself as learned. He will respond to that. All those who are Indians in the audience, may they get up? Who will get up? Only the person who considers himself as Indian. So that requires an identification of the body. One who doesn't have that kind of an identification is neither Indian nor American, neither man nor woman, is nothing. And therefore, he does not respond to any injunctions at all because injunctions do not apply to him. Injunctions or instructions and all the do's and don'ts and code of conduct and everything are applicable. Everything is applicable to whom? To the person who has the sense of doership. When he doesn't have sense of doership, he does not do anything. When he does not do anything, he does not interfere with the activities taking place at the level of body or the speech of the mind. So whether these activities are in keeping with these scriptural injunctions or they are not, that also he is not concerned about. Or maybe he might feel concerned about it. And therefore, the person may deliberate, may choose to act in a manner which is in keeping with scriptural injunctions in order to set an example. So Lord Krishna says in the third chapter of Gita, and that line of thought is now followed in the subsequent verses, where Arjuna was instructed, karmanaiva hi samsiddhim asthita janakadayah lokasangrahamevapi sampashyan kartum arhasi. Hey Arjuna, look, such great kings as Janaka, who was considered a wise man, And therefore he could have as well denounced all the activities and still karmana yuhai samsiddhim, even though he was wise, liberated, and still he chose to continue to perform his duties. What for? Loka sangraham, for the welfare of the people. And therefore, in a way, there is a suggestion here that a wise man also should do something which will bring about the welfare of the people. He doesn't have himself any kind of an agraha or any kind of an insistence that he should be active or inactive. He is not opposed to activity or not opposed to inactivity, because both activity and inactivity are at only the level of the upadhi. But still, he being shrestha, he being an exalted person, he being a leader, or he being the one who is looked upon by so many people, it may as well be that that person may choose to conduct himself or herself in a particular manner in order to set an example for the rest of the people. Because the rest of the people look up to him and they do not understand him, but they will just follow him and they will imitate him. If he withdraws from activities, his disciples and people also will withdraw. If he is active, they will also remain active. And therefore, in order to guide the people, he may choose to adopt a certain mode of activity, engagement or disengagement. That also he may do for the sake of the welfare of the people. When all of this is being said about the wise man, tarhi jnanivat ajnaninavapi pravrattav agraho na yuktahiti asankyah, then somebody says, okay, if the jnani or the wise man does not have any agraha, does not have any preference or insistence upon activity or inactivity, then ignorant person also, why should he have any insistence or any preference? Maybe an ignorant person also need not bother whether the person is acting or not acting. Is it all right? Since wise man doesn't bother, or since wise man is unconcerned whether he or she is engaged in activity or inactivity, should it not be that an ignorant man also be unconcerned about the action? He says, no, that's not right. Says verse 284.
Pravritta vagraho nyayah, pravritta vagraho nyayah, bodhahinasya sarvatha, bodhahinasya sarvatha, svargaya vapavargaya, svargaya vapavargaya, yatitavyam yato nirvihi, yatitavyam yato nirvihi. Now says pravrittau agraha nyayah bodhahinasya sarvatha. What all we said was pertaining to wise man, and the same thing does not apply to an ignorant person. Bodhahinasya, for the person who is ignorant, pravrittau agraha nyayah. In fact, there must be an insistence in activity as far as an ignorant person is concerned. Nyayah, it is only proper. It is only proper that an ignorant person should in fact have a preference or even an insistence for performance of activity. Pattimaha, why do you say that? Why do you say that an ignorant person should necessarily engage in activity? Or inactivity, whatever the case be, svargaya va apavargaya yatitavyam yataha nrubhi. Yataha, since nrubhi, by the human beings, svargaya apavargaya va yatitavyam. Since human beings must necessarily endeavor or strive either to gain what we call the material happiness or happiness in heavens or apavarga, or one should strive to gain what we call liberation. So svarga, bhoga and apavarga, these are the terms used by Sankhya philosophers. Bhoga means material happiness, apavarga means spiritual happiness. There are only these two pursuits in life. Majority of the people follow bhoga, the material happiness. A rare few people will follow what we call apavarga or spiritual happiness. So depending upon the disposition of the person, a person must necessarily strive for either one of these, either bhoga or apavarga, abhyudaya or nishreyasa, material prosperity or spiritual prosperity. One must necessarily strive.
So an ignorant person should never give up activity. Because some people have very fascination for sannyasa, or renunciation of activity. And Lord Krishna warns in Bhagavad Gita, sannyasastu mahabaho dukkham aptum ayogataha. If one does not have the discipline of the yoga, that sannyasa or renunciation of activity becomes a cause of great difficulty. It's not easy to remain inactive. Swami must have told the story of that man in the temple who was doing nothing, sitting there in South India in this temple. This one sadhu was there. He would come to the temple like this and sit here in front of the Lord near a wall. That's all, silent, doing nothing. And in that temple, they used to offer rice to the Lord. In every Shiva temple, they offer rice, as we do also in the afternoon. And the quantity of rice offered is in proportion to the size of that linga. There is some proportion there. And that rice then, the prasada, is subsequently distributed to the pujari and other people who are working in the temple. The measure of rice is given to different people depending upon their role or participation. And all of this is outlined in the constitution of the temple. So here it was also said that this man who is sitting in front of the deity doing nothing, he should also be given one measure of rice every day. And this he used to receive is one measure of rice. That's all he needed. He needed some food in order to appease his hunger. He would come, sit before the Lord, doing nothing, saying nothing. At the noon time, in the time of lunch, he would get his one measure of rice. He would quietly eat, sit again for the rest of the day and leave in the evening. This was going on for years. And he said that a new administrator came to this temple, and then he was reviewing all the expenses and whatever, and he discovered that this person was given one measure of rice for doing nothing. He doesn't do any, contribute anything to the temple, and still he gets this. So stop it. No? That's how that measure of rice that was given to this man was discontinued. This fellow waited for his prasad. First day he did not come. Second day also prasad did not come. So what happened? How come my prasad is not coming? He says, sorry, this new executive has come and he has stopped your prasad because you are doing nothing for the temple. You are not doing anything. He says, well, I am sitting here silently. So what? Then anybody can do. So let us see. And therefore, that executive told him, he says, what are you doing here? So I'm just sitting silently, quietly. I can also do that. You don't deserve to get a measure of rice just because you sit doing nothing. He says, well, you try. So next day, this man comes, his executive, and so sits there. He says, I'll demonstrate that I can also sit quietly. So he also came and sat there for a couple of minutes. And he started looking this way and that way. He says, wait a minute, don't look anywhere. Just look straight, you know. It's all right. Then he started doing something, you know, with his fingers. And don't do anything, just sit quietly. He started scratching after a few. Don't scratch, just sit quietly. That fellow got, you know, exhausted. He got suffocated. In 3 minutes, he could not sit quietly even for 3 minutes. He says, now I can understand that this is yours is a great achievement that you are able to sit quietly. It's not easy to really disengage from activity. When work comes to us, we want to avoid it. That's all right. But spend a few days without anything to do and you will get just totally restless. It's not possible for a human being to remain without activity. And therefore, to withdraw from activity and because of some fascination for sannyas or renunciation, is not going to be helpful. So it is said here that bodhahinasya, for an ignorant person, it is only imperative that the person should be engaged in activity. Because yoga, when you perform the action in the spirit of yoga, then alone that action can bring about what we call purification of the heart. An ignorant person should strive to gain the knowledge. But for gaining knowledge, it is necessary that the mind must be pure. For that it is necessary that one should perform action in the spirit of yoga. So says here, this human body is a very rare thing. To get the human birth is a very rare thing. And therefore, this birth should not be wasted. This opportunity should not be wasted. They say that there are 8.4 million kinds of different species in this universe, you know. 8.4 million. And therefore, after death, one can get any one of those things, and then we got that we were fortunate enough to acquire the human birth, shows that there is a great privilege that we are enjoying. And therefore, this privilege of having a human body must be utilized fully. It should not be squandered away or wasted away. And therefore, one should necessarily strive to uplift oneself, either to Swarga, meaning to the heaven, the pleasure, Apavarga, or to Moksha. And so an ignorant person must necessarily strive for that, and for that he should perform whatever activity is required. So a wise man has no agraha or no insistence upon performance of activity or inactivity, but that kind of an imitation should not be done by the ignorant or otherwise person, and otherwise the ignorant person must necessarily be active until his mind is pure or he is totally committed to the pursuit of knowledge. Then continuing the discussion, says here, Vidushaha agraha na yukta hiti uktam. Alright, you say it. That a wise man does not have agraha, meaning he doesn't have any insistence whether he should be active or inactive. Alright. Tarhi karminam madhye vartamanena tena kim kartavyam. Suppose this wise man finds himself in the midst of people who are very active. Karminam madhye. Suppose he finds himself in the midst of people who are very active or devoted to action. Tena kim kartavyam. Then what should this wise man do if he finds himself in the midst of people who are devoted to activity? What should he do? How should he conduct himself? The answer is given in the verse 285.
Vidvamsche tadrusham madhye tishthe tadanurodhatah kayena manasa vacha karotyevakhilah kriyah. Vidvamschet tadrusham madhye tishthet. Vidvan tadrusham karminam madhye tishthet chet. Suppose a wise man finds himself in the midst of, the situation brings him, in the midst of people who are devoted to activity. Then what should he do? Tad anurodhatah, meaning tesham anusarena. He should also act according to the people in the midst of whom he is. So in Rome you should be a Roman, that's all it means. And therefore in the midst of active people you should also be active. So wise man, even though he doesn't have to perform activity, and still he should perform action when he is in the midst of people who are active. Tat anurodhatah, meaning tesham anusarena. And what sort of action should he perform? Like the action that they are performing. Kayena manasa vacha, by the body, by the speech, by the mind, sarvaha kriyaha karoti eva. He also performs actions similar to the actions performed by these people at the level of body, speech and the mind. Natan karminaha nivare. He should not in any way discourage these people from action. Says Lord Krishna in Bhagavad Gita, saktah karmanya vidvamsaha yatha kurvanti bharata kuryad vidvams tatha saktah chikirshur loka sangraham. Says that this vidwan, the wise man also, should perform the activity with the same kind of an enthusiasm as the ignorant people are performing. Except that the motivation for the ignorant people comes from the result that the actions will bring. Whereas the motivation that the wise man has is what we call loka sangraha, or the welfare of the people. So here is a wise man in the midst of ignorant people. All these people are devoted to their personal welfare, and motivated by the desire of the personal welfare, all of them are active. What should he do? He should also act like with the same energy or enthusiasm as they are acting. Except that his motivation does not come from the personal welfare, his motivation comes from the welfare of the other people. That's the only difference. Kuryad vidvan tatha asaktah. Those fellows are attached to the results of the action.
this one should be unattached to the personal welfare or benefit, but should act in the same manner as the other people are acting. In fact, it should act and he should lead them and he should guide them. Na buddhimedam janayet ajnanam karma sanginam. Lord Krishna says, do not unsettle the mind of the people. Ignorant people know only, they only think that they have to acquire more and more money, they have to acquire more and more pleasures. So artha and kama, so wealth and pleasures are the goal that ordinary people have. And as enthused by achievement or motivated by that achievement, they are performing action. Suppose you go in the midst of these people, what will you do? Will you tell them, stupid fellow, stop acting? All of you renounce activities. What are you doing? You are pursuing the material pleasures which are all ephemeral, and there is no happiness, not even a trace of happiness in the objects of the world, and therefore would you advise them like this? Lord Krishna says, don't go out and advise people, because that will completely unsettle them. They are merrily performing active actions, thinking that the actions brings desirable ends, and therefore they are performing actions. And when you tell them that there is no happiness in the outside world, happiness is only in the self, that there is not even an iota of happiness in the objects and achievements, suppose you give this kind of an advice or upadesha to these people, that will only unsettle them. And therefore, don't unsettle the mind of the people when you go out. On the other hand, encourage them, joshayet sarvakarmani, encourage them to perform vidvan yukta samacharan. The vidwan or a wise man also should act along with them and inspire them or engage them into activity also. Direct them to perform activities, because action is required for an ignorant person. Wise man goes in the midst of the ignorant persons. He should act and also motivate them or encourage them to also perform action. Natan karminah nivare. He should not in any way stop those people from activity. You should also act, remaining in the midst of them. All right. This is how you should do when in the midst of people who are devoted to action. Asteva tatva bhutsuna madhye avastitasya kurtimaha. Suppose a wise man finds himself in the midst of the seekers of knowledge, then what should he do? Tattva bhutsuna madhye avastirasya. Tattva bhutsuna tattva jignyasu. So if there are aspirants or there are people, there are seekers who are seeking knowledge, and if the wise man finds himself in the midst of these people, tasya krityam, what should he do? That is being said in the verse 286.
मध्ये बुभुत्सूनां यदा तिष्ठेत् तदा पुनः बोधायैषां क्रियाः सर्वाः दूषयं स्त्यजतु स्वयं।
Eshaha bhutsunam madhye yadatishthet. Suppose a wise man finds himself in the midst of bhutsu, meaning the people seeking knowledge. Tada punaha, then what should he do? His role now is completely different, or his behavior is going to be quite different. Tada punaha, then bodhaya esham kriyaha sarvaha dushayan. Esham bodhaya, when he is in the midst of the people seeking knowledge, then he should encourage them. Esha vidvan bhutsunam madhye yadatishthet. When he finds himself in the midst of the seekers of knowledge, esham bhutsunam bodhaya tattva jnana janaya taha kriyaha dushayan svam vityajatu. In fact, to these people, he should show the faults or the harm that is involved in performance of activity. Whereas in the midst of the active people, he encouraged them to act and showed them the need and the benefits of performance of actions. When on the other hand, he is in the midst of the seekers of knowledge, then he should dissuade them from activity. Dushayan, he should show the dosha or the defects involved in the performance of activity. That action only brings about a limited result. And what you are seeking is limitless. Every action only brings about a limited result. And therefore an action can never be a means for attainment of the limitless. Nor can a series of actions be a means of attainment of the limitless. And therefore, show therefore the limitations of the action.
Na karmana na prajaya dhanena tyage neke amrutatva manasuhu. Says the Upanishad, Eke amrutatva manasuhu. Eke means some wise people, amrutatva manasuhu. Some wise people attain immortality. Some wise people attain immortality. How did they attain immortality? Na karmana, not by action. Na prajaya, not by progeny. Na dhanena, not by wealth. Then how did they attain immortality? Tyagena, by renunciation. So this is how he would tell them. He has many faces. He tells something to some person, something else to somebody else, depending upon the nature of the person. Like a doctor, he gives different medicines to different patients, depending upon their disease and their needs. And so also a wise man says different things to different people and does different things to different people. So therefore, this is our experience. Somebody comes for an advice, Swami, should I get married or not? Yes, you should get married. Somebody else comes for an advice, no, don't get married. People get, they say, what is this? You are saying one thing to this one person and quite opposite to the other person, naturally because that is according to the disposition of that person. And so also, when the wise man is in the midst of these people seeking knowledge, then what is the means for knowledge? Nivruti. Pursuit of knowledge requires disengagement from activity. As we said in the morning, and we'll continue to say tomorrow or day after, that what is required for action, for pursuit of knowledge is a mind at leisure. A mind that is free from the demands and therefore free from the duties. So all the duties are renounced by the one. This is the Indian tradition. That is, we will talk about it in the morning class more than here. But therefore, to these people, he should show the limitations of action and dissuade them from engaging in action so that they have all this free time available to them for the pursuit of knowledge. So he says that some wise people attain immortality not by action, nor by progeny, nor by wealth, but by renunciation. Lord Krishna also says in Bhagavad Gita, Sarva dharman parityajya mamekam sharanam vraja. Says, Sarva dharman parityajya, giving up all the dharma, giving up all the actions, meaning giving up all of the pursuits, mamekam sharanam vraja. May you take refuge of me alone. May I be your own sole pursuit, and may you give up every other pursuit. Who am I? I am a very self, and therefore may the knowledge of the self be your sole pursuit, giving up every other pursuit. This is what Lord Krishna says, meaning recommends there the renunciation of action for the seekers of knowledge. And this is what here the author says a wise man should do when he is in the midst of the seekers of knowledge. He should encourage them to give up the activity by showing them the defects or limitations of action so that they can pursue the knowledge, totally. They can be committed to the pursuit of knowledge. Kutah evam kartavyam. Why should it be done like this? That is answered in the verse 287.
Avidvadanusarena vrittir buddhasya yujyate, vrittir buddhasya yujyate, stanandhayanusarena vartate tatpitayatah, vartate tatpitayatah. Avidvad anusarena vrittihi buddhasya yujyate. Ajnani anusarena jnaninaha vartanam uchitam. Says, a wise man should act as required
by the people who are around him. Agnani anusarena, in keeping with the people, in keeping with the ignorant people, or what is good for the ignorant people, accordingly the wise man should act. Why is it so? Kripalutva, because he is kripalu, because a wise man is necessarily a person of great compassion. Tesham anukampaniyatvacha, and those people, ignorant people, really are anukampaniya, they deserve compassion. Compassion is the nature of the wise person, and the ignorant person need compassion also. That being the case, out of compassion, the wise person should do whatever is needed for the ignorant people, for their welfare. Meaning, if it is thought that action is good for them, well, he should act. Or he should teach them to act, he should give them instruction or encourage them to act. And if he thinks that disengagement of action is proper for them, then he should teach them or encourage them to disengage from activity and commit themselves to knowledge. And thus he should do whatever is proper for those people, because he has no agraha or insistence from his own standpoint.
Evam kvadrashtam, where do you find this? Stanandhaya anusarena vartate tat pitayaha. Stanandhaya stanapana kartaha shkartaraha shishavaha ityartaha.
Use here an example, an infant who is sucking for the milk. So this infant, what does the father do? The father does whatever is good for this little infant, that's all.
So stanandhaya anusarena vartate tat pitayaha.
Yataha, since the father always acts in accordance as required by an infant, and so also out of compassion for the infant, out of the care for the infant, and whatever the infant requires, so the father does, and similarly also whatever the people around them require, so the wise man does, out of compassion, out of care and concern for them.
Okay, we'll continue tomorrow, and I think we'll be able to complete the chapter tomorrow.
Om Purnamadah Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi. Shankaram Shankaracharyam Keshavam Vadarayanam. Sutra-bhāśya-krutau vande bhagavantau punah-punah. Īśvaro guru-rātmedi murti-bheda-vibhāgine. Vyoma-vadvyāpta-dehāya dakṣinā-mūrtaye namah. Om shanti shanti shanti. Harihi Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha. Harihi Om.